Hi, I'm Maria Ho. I've been playing poker professionally for the last 10 years, and these are my top 5 tips for low buy-in, big field poker tournaments. Number 5, capitalize on other players' mistakes. I think early on, especially with these big fields and the structure of the tournament, a lot of people get a little frenzied and they think, okay, I have to get my hands on a lot of chips quick, or they start kind of playing the same tempo as their opponents of this, you know, wanting to re-enter, rebuy, and gambling a lot. And I think that you're putting yourself in a much better position when you are sitting back a little bit more and capitalizing on all of these players that are making these mistakes than being the one to rush in head first and get too involved and then make all of the mistakes yourself. Number 4, play in position and target the weak opponents. I think there's still a lot of great spots to be active, so just because you might be playing a tighter style doesn't mean that you can't get involved in pots that are easy to win, especially when it comes to situations like raising in late position against several people. A lot of times, you're gonna be able to pick up the pot before the flop and you're not even really gonna have to do much. Nobody likes to play out of position. That's just plain and simple. People feel like they're on the defense, and it's really great in poker when you're on the offense and everyone else is on the defense, and playing in position helps you do that. And you should also be targeting the weaker opponents at your table. When a weak opponent opens the pot and another weak player calls behind them and you're in position, these are the pots that you should be much more willing to get involved in, especially because not only do you have position, but because of the players that you're gonna be up against, because these weaker opponents are the type where they're gonna overplay their hand, and if you, you know, have a really good flop, you're gonna be able to stack them, or if, you know, they don't hit the board, they're very likely to give up because they're weak and more passive, and you can take down the pot without even having a big hand. So playing marginal holdings in these spots in position is actually really beneficial because of who your opponents are. Number 3, look for good spots to 3-bet shove when you have 20 big blinds. Typically in these tournaments, there's a point, you know, several levels in where most of the stacks get very shallow, meaning you have anywhere from, you know, 15 to 20 big blind stacks. And at this point, you don't really want to be calling many hands off of that stack, and there will be aggressive players at your table that will recognize that most of the stacks at their table is in this 15 to 20 big blind stack zone, where they'll just be pounding the blinds and raising every hand because of it, because they know you're kind of handcuffed to going all in or folding. And I think the best way to combat these kinds of aggressive players that are raising a lot is to find spots where you should 3-bet shove your stack against their opens. And the reason why a 15 to 20 big blind stack is a really good stack to do that with is because you still have fold equity, meaning you still have enough chips that they can't just call you with any two cards or any hand that they raise with. But it's also a really effective way to pick up, you know, 10 to 15 to 20% of your stack, essentially, depending on where the antes are and how big the blinds are, without even having to go to showdown, and you're not really risking your tournament life. Well, obviously, the first part is recognizing which one of your opponents are the ones that are opening very, very wide. But then the second part is figuring out what is also a hand with decent equity that, if called, would play well against what they're opening with. And I would say, you know, a really good example of that is I'm much more weighted when I 3-bet shove with 20 big blind stacks towards hands like Jack 10 suited or, you know, King Queen suited than Ace X. Because if you 3-bet shove with Ace X and you get called by, you know, any ace that's gonna have you crushed, then you're in a horrible spot. But if you 3-bet shove with Jack 10 suited and you get called by Ace King, you're actually not that far behind. So you just have to know which hands are gonna play well against the hands that are opening that are willing to call your stack. But oftentimes you can expect that they'll probably just fold to your stack. Number 2, don't be afraid of the bubble. It's extremely important when you're on the bubble to recognize that this is an opportunity for you to get a lot of chips and to amass a big stack without having to risk a lot of chips, because at this point, most of the opponents at your table are kind of trying to just squeeze into the money. So they're not really willing to play a lot of hands. They're definitely not calling in marginal situations. They're just fearful of having to put their tournament life at stake at some point in the hand, and then they just end up not playing any hands at all. And I think a lot of people have that common fear of, you know, getting that close to finally being on the bubble and then just wanting to make it past that hump of actually being in the money. And I think whether you have a huge stack or just an average stack, I think you should really hone in on the opportunities where you can easily take down pots with very little resistance. Because a lot of times you get people that are defending their blinds, but during the bubble, people kind of stop defending their blinds. So if you have weak opponents that you know are trying to squeeze into the money, or they have short stacks in the blinds, then you should always be trying to raise and target those specific people in the blinds at that time. I also think that during bubble play, there's a lot of players that will raise because they think it's easy, but then they won't really call three bets. So I think that's also a good situation to kind of take note of when you see that someone's starting to abuse the bubble in their mind, which is raising a lot of pots maybe, but you also know that they're somewhat afraid to play a big pot, especially out of position, then you can take that opportunity to start three betting those players light in position. Number one, start building reads for the final table before you get there. So I think most people think of the tournament as two separate tournaments. The tournament all the way up to the final table, and then when the final table begins, it's a completely different tournament. And to me, I think it's really important to know that they are not two separate tournaments, and you're not waiting to get to the final table. Before you even get there, you should be building reads on your opponents and recognizing patterns in the way that they play. And I think the best time to do that is when you're down to about five tables in the tournament, because at that point, with there always being a redraw at three tables and sometimes even at two tables, you're going to have played with all of your opponents that you will be playing if you were to make the final table before you even make the final table. And that's why it's also really important to pay attention even if you yourself are not involved in the hand. I think a lot of players, they start zoning out when they're not in the hand, and you know, they'll be on their phone or whatever. But you're missing out on so much valuable information, because they're still gonna end up turning their hands over a lot of the times against these opponents. And then you'll be able to pick up on what kind of hands they're playing and what kind of hands they're willing to go all in with.